Wir schreiben 2017, die Welt scheint aus den Fugen. Der Globus in der Hand von Kapital und Despoten. Forschung und Technik erklimmen begeisternde Höhen. Doch im Dienste des Profits hast du die Menschheit stöhnen.
It's 2017, the world seems to be turned upside down. The globe in the hands of capital and despots. Research and technique are at their highest stage, but in the service of the prophet you hear humanity moan. Feedful aversion, one born in decadence, others counting their rice groans every day. Some have billions, billions have nothing. Contradiction is an outcry, which is, which could be. Does it have to be like this forever? In the midst of the global conflagration. In 1917, a strong hand came up by war, exploitation, hunger and death, cry for peace, freedom and bread. In the midst of the global conflagration, soldiers, peasants and workers stood up, and war, exploitation, hunger and nonsense, long live October Revolution. Patiently conquered the hearts of the masses, then boldly called for an uprising under Aurora's thunder. The Bolsheviki are freeing, liberating the huge Russia. A big, final part of humanity freed from the dictatorship by capital. So no, stop, there's no way we can do it, stop. It's all nonsense. 1917, socialism and millions were part. Immediately hatred of the imperialists, sympathy of the workers worldwide. Until today, there's slander, but we have the choice. Let's understand the message. People hear the signals. Dear people of Gelsenkirchen, dear people from Horst, dear guests from near and far, dear representatives of the press, time has come. The first song was called 1917 by the music groups Gehörwäsche from Cologne and Pueblos from Rhein-Main area. Thank you. 1917, it's not only the song. It was the year of the October Revolution, and today, here, we are gonna unveil and erect the first statue of its leader, Vladimir Ilyich Lenin, in Western Germany. Now I ask Gabi Fechtner, the party chairperson of MLPD, to start her introductory speech. Welcome, Gabi Fechtner. Dear people of Gelsenkirchen, dear people of Horst, who partially are listening from the balconies, dear people who have come here from all over the world, dear representatives of the press, dear friends and comrades, every era has its statues. The era of the memorials for racists, anti-Semites, fascists, anti-communists, and other ultra-reactionaries is definitely over. And rightfully so, these statues are being toppled all over the world at the moment. But what comes after that? Every rebellion needs a positive goal if it is not to end in frustration, old ways or defeats. Thus, after attempted bans, heated discussions, court decisions, much excitement in the international press, today I cordially welcome you to the unveiling ceremony for the first statue of Vladimir Ilyich Ulyanov Lenin in West Germany. Welcome. I was often asked during the past weeks whether the erection of the statue was intended as a provocation. No, it's not a provocation. But perhaps it might be a certain breaking of a taboo. A breaking of the taboo in this regard that in this society where anti-communism is state religion, there's not on the agenda to discuss about socialism, to honor the representatives of socialism in a positive way. Thus, we say, in a situation where criticism of capitalism is all over the place, or everywhere, we have to stop that anti-communism can create a situation where people think it's better to stay away from communism. Some of you might know it, if you advocate socialism and take a position, you are quickly labeled as an extremist or even a Maoist or Stalinist. Also, for the sake of bringing down anti-communism's reservations and bans of the thinking, if you want to save this way, this day we conduct as a climax of the movement, don't give anti-communism a chance. We demand an open democratic discussion about socialism, about the perspective of socialism and the freedom ideology of communism. And as we can see, even this state here, there is a broad discussion. The discussion has already been emerging in the media. The city of Gelsenkirchen made a big exhibition here about communism. They've started reacting. They want to bring up their own memorial. And I can only welcome the discussion. But what we also claim is that it has to be done in a democratic way on eye level, that our positions are there on eye level. And in this way, we welcome every discussion. I'd also like to say that we also invited critical speakers. Over there we see the FDP and we said, hey FDP, if you can contribute something in a factual way, you can speak. But the FDP turned down this democratic discussion, so you make your own picture who acts in a democratic way in this discussion.
Wir setzen also mit diesem Lenin, und das ist das, was wir hier bezweckt haben, wir setzen einen Pflock, das ist
so, with this Lenin, and this is what we intended to do, we are setting a sign that there must come an end to the situation that the discussion about socialism cannot be conducted in a democratic and equal way, and we need it in this situation. Today, we witness an accelerated tendency towards a general societal crisis of the imperialist world system. And by that I mean it's not just a crisis where the one or the other law or the one or the other question is criticized, but the entire societal basis is being called into question. And I, especially in the so-called role model democracy in the USA today, we are experiencing the biggest world economic and financial crisis in the history of capitalism. Capitalism and this crisis have already sent hundreds of millions of people. Only in the US, 40 million people were sent to unemployment. It's often linked to poverty. All over the world, new starvation crises are threatening us that we haven't seen before. At the same time, society generated worth has grown immensely. Since 2014, the equity capital of the 500 biggest corporations has increased from $11 trillion to almost $18 trillion. Think about that. For the 500 biggest corporations, $18 trillion, while the poorer half of the world population owns only $2 trillion. Such an inequality in the world. We witness, and we are really emotional about this, a global health crisis, which officially the estimated number of unreported cases is several times higher. But it has caused the death of almost 500,000 people. The warnings of the World Health Organization about such a pandemic were not taken seriously for many years by almost all the world governments, so they are also responsible for this. The refugee crisis, with more than 20,000 deaths in the Mediterranean Sea since 2014, the environmental crisis, the crisis of the bourgeois family system are intensifying. And it is questioning the system at all. This is all the result of capitalism, which now only exists in a crisis mode. The fundamental contradiction of capitalism, the production is social while appropriation is private, is carried more and more to extremes. And this contradiction is intensifying to a dangerous and increased hunt for spheres of power, for maximum profit and influence for the tiny stratum of solely ruling international finance capital. It is questioning all our livelihood. To say it in short, this general societal crisis cries out for a general societal change. We say the answer to this crisis is genuine socialism. And if we say that, we must deal with the past experience of humanity in the construction of socialism. For this, Lenin's merits are immortal. Applause for Lenin. In the middle of the First World War, he analyzed and qualified the dying parasitic capitalism as the eve of the socialist revolution. He was the brilliant leader and also organizer of the October Revolution and led the construction of the first socialist country in the world. He proved it's possible to overcome capitalism. Today they are acting as if it's out of any imagination. Lenin proved it's possible. Socialism can be built and capitalism is not the end of history. In a complicated situation, he dared to call for the overthrow of the government in order to build socialism and to safeguard the successes of the democratic revolution against brutal Tsarist rule and the counter-revolution at that time. Lenin's accurate analysis, his far-sighted forecasts, and also his sure hand in issues of tactics stem from his theoretical work and also his ability to master the dialectical method on the highest level. So to almost creatively analyze the situation and to bring it forward, this analysis. And one thing on the life of Lenin, he was a highly educated man, lawyer. He maintained a lively and critical exchange with artists and writers of his day, also with bourgeois journalists and scientists all over the world. At the same time, it was so important for him to closely merge with the life and struggle of the workers, of the common peasants, whose interests always guided his actions. He checked everything, examined it. Is it in the interest of the workers and the common peasants? After the October Revolution, Lenin lived in a small two-room apartment. Clara Zetkin, which is a famous German women's activist and a communist, and I would like to quote her, what she said after she visited Lenin, because it shows what kind of man Lenin was. She said, "But his private dwelling was of the utmost simplicity and unpretentiousness. It was well known that the peasants provided their Ilyich, how people called him at that time, with gifts of white flour, bacon, eggs, fruits, and so on. But it was also well known that nothing remained in Lenin's household. Everything found its way to the hospitals and children's homes. Lenin's family held strictly to the principle of not living better than everyone else. Unquote of Clara Zetkin. Lenin. And you can feel it in how someone lives, in his whole thinking, acting and feeling. He was revolutionary. He was not the one to make lonely decisions. Just been asked, isn't that a personality cult? Lenin was a team worker. He made it very clear that it's so important to consult his closest collaborators. He gathered information from all people who were competent in a specific subject area, peasants, workers, whoever could contribute something in his specific subject area. Everyone was included by Lenin into the joint work. So he was a new type of a statesman, as brilliant as he was modest. Lenin was unrelenting towards bureaucrats with party membership books who only protected their own interests. At the end of his life, he foresaw that a change in the mode of thinking of leading functionaries in the party at that time, in the enterprises, administration, that this change of the mode of thinking could give rise to a restoration, to a betrayal of socialism and restoration of capitalism. So he created an independent controlling body. He said the Central Committee must be controlled independently from above. Under Lenin's leadership, the betrayal of socialism was prevented with these measures and others. However, later, exactly this became sad reality. Lenin devoted his entire life to the struggle for the freedom of the oppressed. Lenin also stands for the achievements enacted directly following the October Revolution in 1917. With one of the first decrees, the expropriation of big landowners without compensation and the distribution of the land among the poor peasants were ordered and carried out immediately. The feudal estates and the nobility were abolished and their property confiscated. We're having a huge discussion to only have a taxes for high incomes. So these were huge progress at that time. The rights of the national minorities, including even the right to break away from a state of their own, were proclaimed. The Soviet system, also the organs of workers' control, were organized, first in the factories and then extending to the entire state. The 8-hour day was introduced in the factories by law immediately. Imagine that today workers have to work 12 hours again, in the hospitals 24 hours, they have to be there. So how much we have regressed from the situation that we had more than 100 years ago in the socialist state. Men and women, legitimate and illegitimate, children were given equal rights, usury was prohibited, banks and factories socialized, health insurance was introduced, and so on. Lenin, by the way, created for Russia as one of the first countries in the world. There was the death penalty in all the countries, and Lenin stepped in to abolish that, and he did it. It was implemented. So what had been seen for centuries as impossible, all of a sudden it was possible. Why? Because society's paradigms had changed. If you have other paradigms in society and not the maximum profit is in the center of attention, then you can quickly change things and place the interests of the masses in the first place, which is why we say we stand for a socialist society, for revolutionary overthrowing this capitalist societal system. Dear listeners, you might have noticed that I left out one very important decree. It was even the first decree after the October Revolution, the decree on the peace negotiations to immediately end First World War, to offer an immediate armistice, and it was offered to the main imperialist powers immediately. In March 1918, peace was concluded, despite Lenin had to accept large losses of territory. He said, this is the most important thing now that we have peace. We will do it even if we have to give away a big part of the territory. They can't do it today in Syria. Every imperialist who's acting there is fighting for everything, every kilometer. So also the peace policy was unique in socialism. Many achievements, but still, I think some might think now, well, you cannot paint it in such a positive way. Isn't it a bit simple or simplified? Or you can also have a completely different opinion. Let's have a look how people could have another opinion and what Lenin was accused of then. Right after the October Revolution, from March 1918, 14 capitalist and imperialist countries launched a military attack with aggressive anti-Leninist slogans. They all united. Before that, they were waging war against each other, but against socialism, all of a sudden, they agreed and attacked the country. In Germany, two forces were mobilized. Amongst them, the later fascist brigade Ehrhardt was part of this attack against the socialist Soviet Union. The Russian workers and peasants then followed the call of Lenin, who said, "We need to defend our country, we need to defend socialism. And we will not give up on these achievements." And what did the reactionaries, the ones that attacked the country, exactly these people then called out, "Oh, Lenin, the mass murderer." Imagine that. I don't know if you know. Some people think this term, Lenin is a mass murderer, comes from CDU or SPD. They massively spread it now in press information and everywhere you could read it. Do you know the genuine source of this mass murderer thing? Adolf Hitler personally. Hitler personally gave out this slogan, Lenin is a mass murderer, already in 1920. He had speeches where he said that. So with this battle cry, the victims of the war that took place then are simply attributed to Lenin. The victims of this attack, to the revolutionaries who defended themselves, who had a justified defense war, and it is shameful that today SPD and CDU are taking up this battle cry again, are spreading it, and we also condemn this reactionary writing of history, which is not true, and we have to put it on the right way again. It's also interesting what coalitions are built today if it is about anti-communism. It was all over the media, the quote that was made directly here in the District Assembly Gelsenkirchen West. I quote, "The communist leader Lenin stands for violence, oppression, terror and horrible human suffering." End of quote. Do you know who made this? A really big coalition of Greens, SPD, CDU, FDP, and who else? AfD, of course, surely. Right before that, it was a big scandal that in Thuringia, Kemmerich was elected as a minister president of the AfD, by the FDP. But now it was clear that that all the bourgeois parties agree with the AfD. We criticized this big coalition of anti-communism, and we have countered it with a lot of convincing work. But we also have to state the bourgeois public has almost been used to that these horror stories about communism are being told. The anti-communism in Germany, that it works so well, is mainly due to that it can be adopted, and every discussion in the broad frame is just told that it is unnecessary. Have you seen anyone of MLPD in talk shows? You see Altmaier, I think he can double or triple himself. You see always the same people in the discussions in these talk shows, but MLPD doesn't seem to take place there, and in this way anti-communism can be spread. Modern anti-communism seemingly embraces democratic values and then tries to make it look as if these values are best realized in capitalism, whereas socialism means only crimes and lack of freedom. modern anti-communism even objects to being called anti-communists. Under the slogan, everyone can have his or her opinion, but of course, there's no way that you can have contact to the Stalinist or Maoist of MLPD. There's the strict line. With this battle terms, everyone who thinks is a big bourgeois people cannot go there, and this is the end of the story. That's the logic. I want to make it clear, I'm neither a Stalinist nor a Maoist. The same goes for the MLPD. However, we defend the achievements of socialism and its representatives, Marx, Engels, Lenin, Stalin and Mao. Mao Zedong. Of course, it is easy today to wag the finger at those who fought at that time and to slander their mistakes. I put the counter question, where would we be today if these people would not have fought in severe struggles against the Tsar, against other oppression? They had fought, they were superior to Hitlerite fascism. Where would we be today, these Democrats who claim their opinion today? We couldn't be here today if these fights hadn't been fought. Doubtless, and this is also normal for MLPD, we have no problem saying that doubtless these personalities, these leading personalities too, were not free of faults and errors. It would be nonsense to claim that. Doubtless, even during the time of Stalin and Mao Zedong, against their will, crimes also were committed in the name of socialism. In order to achieve socialism again, we even have the greatest interest in investigating errors. We installed a history commission that will examine all of this. But in order to regain the fight for socialism and not to keep capitalism alive and to slander everything else. But let's be honest, government really having a problem, or the monopolies via their channels, the anti-communism is bad. Do they really have a problem with crimes that Stalin or Mao or other socialist country are said to have committed? If the government and they had a problem with mistakes and crimes, I'm questioning how our government can work with regimes in Iran, in Turkey, in Saudi Arabia, in Libya, or with Mr. Trump in the US, how they can support the EU policy that tens of thousands of people are drowning in the Mediterranean. These are not criminals. They don't have a problem with these crimes, but the communists, everything in history is blamed on them. We don't go along with this kind of history writing, and we need to oppose this slander.
Surely, you can make it easy with these so-called stone-built story about capitalism as end of history. But the questions of the time, why the promises for the salvation of the problems of humanity are not being kept in capitalism, why capitalism keeps on bringing about more crises who show its inability, these questions cannot be answered with these simple patterns.
Literature Nobel Prize winner Thomas Mann called anti-communism, I quote, one of the big follies of our epoch, end of quote. Anti-communism clouds the view in a time where clearly thinking is so necessary, when socialism cannot be brought about without overcoming capitalism, and there's also no socialist consciousness without overcoming the anti-communist ideology. This is why the movement Give Anti-Communism No Chance, we've put it on the slogan over there, is the order of the day.
Time is ripe more than ever to win the workers and the masses worldwide for a new upsurge of the struggle for socialism. Dear guests, maybe you are thinking, maybe you should have a more neutral view or not so ideological. They always accuse us of being too ideological. This is exactly how the Gelsenkirchen building authorities justified the banning of the statue in front of the protected facade of this Horster Mitte in February. They seriously said this statue would cover these buildings. We have a lot of filming here, maybe we can check that. I would like to quote what these building authorities said. I quote, the value of the monument, this monument, as an administrative building, is massively impaired by the statue because the political statement which is obviously involved stands in contradiction to the political neutrality of a public administration building. Unquote. Well, first of all, the Horster Mitte has not been an administrative building for now almost 2 decades, even though it's a service center of a new kind, which is here for the needs of the Gelsenkirchen population. It has never been politically neutral, surely, but this Horster Mitte is place of manifold struggles of the miners, some are sitting over there, of the refugee aids, of rebellious youth, also of the struggle against the closure of St. Joseph's Hospital right over there. All of these struggles have been fought here or planned here, and we are proud on this politically not really neutral Horster Mitte and our statue now in front of that. The call for neutrality and freedom of ideology is merely the call for prostrate oneself to bourgeois ideology and so recognize the existing societal relations. Power relations. SPD and CDU claimed that all Horst was against Lenin. They knew it from the beginning. All Horst are against. However, it is our daily business, and contrary to these bourgeois parties, to stand in the city, at the market, go from door to door at the weekly market to find out their positions and to gain our own impressions. From the beginning, we met with clear sympathy in doing so. But of course, as usual, the people of Horst were also argumentative and we had polarized discussions. However, dear people of SPD and CDU, we can also report you, the more you attack Lenin, the more sympathetic he became to the people of Horst, because they said, if these people attack Lenin, then something good must be with him. And many took the opportunity to inform themselves. So anti-communism has considerably lost effect in the heads, things turned, and especially this understanding is what we have of this statue, that it really makes you think. However, also the CDU couldn't be stopped. We have this newcomer, Sascha Kurt, who started an online petition. Several weeks later, however, it only reached 8% of its signature target. Instead of 2,200 people, only 204 people signed against this Lenin statue. I think 160 from Gelsenkirchen. I think Horst and Gelsenkirchen is a bit bigger, so he couldn't even win his city. And then he said, yeah, that was due to the fact that it was Corona. Of course, everyone knows that during times of Corona, internet was used as never before. But of course, it couldn't be used for this petition against Lenin. But this is the problem of Mr. Kurt. The call of the city spokesman Schulmann to prevent the statue through creative activities were taken seriously only by fascists. They tried to do this, they had some stickers on this statue. With the help of people passing by, we could prevent them from harming it, and we would like to call on everyone to further protect the statue, to be vigilant and to point out that no one is to harm the statue and to make sure that it can continue to stand with us. In this connection, I would like to protest determinedly against the fact that the police of Gelsenkirchen enabled the fascists. I mean, it's a very small group, but still, they weren't able to stand over there. And they also enabled the fascists to take on their role as first hit against the communists. It's impossible. No anti-fascist demonstration would be allowed so close to a fascist demonstration. You would be sent out to other neighborhoods. But these fascists can stand under the slogan of the city, no place for Lenin. They are protesting there, and this is also a part of an undemocratic restriction of our events. So if we protest this group over there, however, even though they are not really big. Dear guests, we had to postpone this event. This postponement now enables us that we can celebrate it shortly after the birthday of MLPD, which was founded on 20th June 1982. And until today, we uphold the doctrines of Lenin and Marx to the present day. MLPD is a party of the working class, revolutionary working class party.
These are not the electorate for us, but they set the pace.
80% of our members are workers and low-level salaried employees, also the leadership. I'm a trained tool mechanic. It's also financially independent. We don't rely on donations of some corporations or some donators, but we finance us by little donations and everything the population gives us, which gives us the freedom to say what we want about this dictatorship of the monopolies that we have. We don't have people looking for some positions. We have democratic centralism, in which we discuss democratically, critically, have a debate, but then in a unified way we act. In numerous workers' struggles and fights we played a role. We support struggles of the women, workers, environmental movement, anti-fascism and anti-militarism. We stand for doing the work in the trade unions and factories, which no party is doing anymore. And this situation I'd like to use to make known that we found out that this morning at ThyssenKrupp Duisburg, the workers went on strike against dismissals. Our warmest greetings. There are mass dismissals coming about everywhere, and these workers set a sign with their independent strike. Greetings also to our company group, who's in the first row, always there. So good luck to the workers for their struggle. Our guiding principle is proletarian internationalism and international solidarity. We've also become a trailblazer for the struggle for democratic rights and freedoms against the rightward development of the Merkel-Scholz-Seehofer government in the last years. Our Youth League Rebel organizes the rebellion of the youth, most recently against the racist and anti-communist policies of Trump in the USA. In MLPD, word and deed agree, sound theoretical investigative work and revolutionary practice with backbone, not for nothing. We are surely the most embattled party in Germany in the meantime. Lenin's words are famous. Disunited, the workers are nothing. United, they are everything. This retains their full validity even today, so I would like to invite you on this occasion to strengthen this party and its youth league. Dear guests, you will soon see that we don't have a really high pedestal. There are pictures of huge pedestals. Hercules over here is so many meters above the city. We said we keep the pedestal low because it fits with Lenin, that he meets people on eye level when they go shopping or working. So there's a low pedestal, but there was also criticism at this statue by people who said, why don't you put up Marx? I could do with him better. He's also in your party's name, as we are always open for criticism and accept it. I would like to tell you that next to Lenin, we will also have a Marx statue standing. Thank you.
mit ungebremster Wucht trifft. Schwert auf Schwert.
Sword meets sword with full force. Naked feet in the dust. Body numb with pain.
Die Ränge weiden sich an der Not. Es geht um Leben und Tod.
It's about life or death.
Das Leben meines Sklaven ist
a slave's life is worth nothing. The masters are always untouched. But thousands of painful bodies and souls are standing up. Nobody can dampen the pleasure to fight for your own freedom for the first time. Entire legions fall. Roman senators are shaking. 3 years of Spartacus uprising. Choke and blood, but still known. Freedom. Hundreds of thousands cry it out. An old dream not to be silenced. Freedom.
Schein und Gott, tausend Fehlen, ein alter Traum nicht tot zu kriegen.
Still not equal. Still poor and rich. Still masters in power. On to the next battle. Dust in his lung. Deep in the shaft, it's dark even when it's day. Fearlessly faces death, extracts the wealth of the soil. Nature plundered, miners are kept down, and only the cold hand of the prophet. Every generation works and fights. Freedom only by revolution. Freedom. Hundreds of thousands cry it out, an old dream not to be silenced.
Ja, herzlichen Dank.
Thank you for this song Freedom and also for the clear and pugnacious words before of Gabi Fechtner, party chairwoman of LPD. Now we'll be listening to a speech of Stefan Engel. He used to be party chairman of LPD for 37 years and he's the head of the theoretical organ of LPD, the writings of Revolutionary Way, Revolutionärer Weg. Welcome, Stefan Engel. Dear guests, dear colleagues, dear friends, dear comrades, today, exactly 38 years ago, we founded the Marxist-Leninist Party of Germany. Back then, we had an important debate on what would be the right party name. We decided for the name Marxist-Leninist Party of Germany. The delegate Helga Janczyk from Gelsenkirchen, a cleaning woman who organized the first cleaning women's strike in Germany in 1976, spoke on this on the party congress. I quote, at our local assembly, none of the comrades had spoken for MLPD. We feared that the workers could mistake us for a theoretical circle. What we did not see is that we had a one-sided approach. Especially we as communists must carry Marxism-Leninism into the working class. In our work, Marxism-Leninism is the starting point, and we are obliged to spread it amongst the workers. If we didn't do that, we would be at the mercy of reformism and revisionism and would withhold the path of socialism from the working class. End of quote of our Helga. The party name MLPD had another advantage. The name was quite unknown in the working class and did not have a negative connotation yet like the name Communist Party. The name MLPD stands for Party of a New Type, as Lenin always demanded it, after we are in a new epoch of party building. With the founding of the DKP in 1968, it became obvious that it would follow the revisionist path of KPDSU and SED. The reconstruction of the Revolutionary Working Class Party in Germany became necessary. MLPD has Marx and Lenin in its name because we refer to scientific socialism, which is closely connected to the names Marx and Engels and was decisively further developed from Lenin by Lenin to our epoch. Marx scientifically criticized the capitalist mode of production. He proved that this capitalist economy leads to crisis again and again. For 50 years, all bourgeois parties are denying this in Germany, even though we are in another world economic and financial crisis again. Why do they deny it? They try to call it recession, a completely arbitrary term, which does not even reflect what crisis means, that the system of this economy has been disturbed and it doesn't work now. Marx also developed the doctrine of the class struggle, of the necessity of dictatorship of proletariat. He called capitalism the dictatorship of capitalists, and he said we need a dictatorship of the oppressed, of the exploited, of the proletariat to counter that, those who have no interest at all to exploit people, because these people are used to be selfless, to work selflessly for the people. And we want the entire society to be so selfless, and nobody exploits or oppresses anyone else. This is dictatorship of proletariat. And Marx and Engels also developed dialectical and historical materialism as world outlook of the communists. Lenin was not only Marxist, he was not only filled with all the doctrines of Marx and Engels, he knew them all. But he was also a genius theoretician of Marxism. In the midst of the First World War, he analyzed that the capitalism, since the turn of the century, had developed further to imperialism. This imperialism was based on the monopolization of the big capital. For them, it was not enough anymore to exploit the own workers. Imperialism means, beyond that, the capitalist exploitation of entire countries or colonies. Imperialism is the next stage forward of capitalism. Today, they completely denied that there is imperialism anymore. Maybe in First World War they teach it in schools. No, imperialism is the mode of existence of the capitalist system today. There's still a handful of capitalist countries who exploit the majority of the countries, the workers, the resources. Imperialism is the biggest problem today for humankind. In the struggle for the redistribution of the world, the German imperialism unleashed the First World War with its 20 million deaths and unseen barbarity in humankind. Lenin stick to the decisions of the Socialist International of 1910 in Stuttgart, where the social democratic parties of all countries agreed, the socialist parties, that in the case of a war, no worker was to shoot another worker of another country. And these socialist, social democratic parties would reject every imperialist war. But what happened? All social democratic parties turned around. Also the Social Democratic Party of Germany, who agreed to the war credits for the empire and went on to social chauvinism. Lenin's party was the only one who stick with this anti-war position of the Socialist International, which is why in the end they were able to win the decisive majority of the Russian people and the working class for the October Revolution. They did not want any war. They found it is right to end this damn war finally. Lenin analyzed the war and he saw it as an expression, the most extreme expression of the decay and decadency of the imperialist system. He concluded the necessity of an international socialist revolution, which actually made the start with the October Revolution in Russia in 1917. His peace policy, in the end, was crucial for winning the decisive majority of the working class and the peasants in Russia. Lenin also called, in a principal way, the opportunists and the social democracy to account, which, instead of decisively leading the struggle for peace, bowed down from militarism and the empire. In this way, they stepped over to social chauvinism and degenerated to a reformist appendix of the empire. Lenin, I remember my grandma saying she was a member in the social democracy. She was also one of the first leaving the SPD and joining Spartakus Bund in 1916. In a close relation to Lenin, and also later in 1918, she was one of the founders of KPD. Leninism means to apply Marxism to the age of imperialism and the proletarian revolution, and to further develop it. If today we profess to Marxism-Leninism, of course we know that the texts, books, readings and writings of Marx and Lenin are more than 100 years old, and they cannot be compared to today's concrete social relations. At that time, there was not even 7 or 8 imperialist countries. 7 or 8. Today, you can count about every 4th or 5th country of the world to be imperialist. The rest of the countries are neo-colonial and dependent capitalist countries. At Lenin's times, there was only a small number of international monopolies. Today we speak of almost 120,000 international monopolies competing over the world market, and they have distributed. Lenin found out that the rule of monopolies more and more merged into state monopoly capitalism, which means the monopolies completely subordinated the state operators. The organs of the monopolies melted with the organs of the state, and in this way the monopolies erected their complete dictatorship over the entire society, even the non-monopolistic bourgeoisie. This is why we are speaking about dictatorship of monopolies. We see it every day, like how this Merkel government completely shies away from the monopolies. They can do whatever they want. This government still remains as a servant. If VW pollutes the entire world with their cars, if the environment is destroyed because our AG wants to continue to burn coal, whatever. Whenever something happens, the interests of the monopolies are being protected on the cost of the working people and the mass of the population. The respective government is only a servant of the ruling monopolies, even if it has a left touch or tries to get one. In order to comprehend the conditions in today's time, Marx and Lenin gave us a crucial instruction with their theoretical foundations. With the dialectical materialist method, they also laid the decisive weapon into our hand to correctly handle the theory of Marx and Engels. Because Marxism-Leninism does not know dogmatism, any kind of it. Always. Again and again, Marx and Lenin emphasized that the concrete analysis of the concrete situation is the living essence of Marxist theory. Our party placed a lot of emphasis from the beginning to adapt this method, to make it our own, because the party building in Germany had to be oriented to the concrete conditions in Germany and in the world today. It could not just be a cheap copy of the old communist movement. This was our decisive difference to the rest of the ML movement in Germany. At the time, in 1972, we had 152 Marxist-Leninist groups and parties, which all claimed to be the Marxist-Leninist party. Except of MLPD, they all vanished as a national thing. There are smaller groups still. But typically for all of them was that they all tried to copy the old KPD in every detail. KPW and the other organizations, but they failed with that. They said the people would be stupid because they don't understand us. No, it was the other way around. These Marxist-Leninist big heads in the students' movement did not understand the masses. This is why they failed and why they are only part of history books now. With the help of the materialist dialectics, we analyze continuously the insights of new phenomena, essential changes in nature and society. And on this basis, we are able to bring a correct prognosis on the future development. The crisis 2008 was even written in our book in 2003. In the Götterdämmerung about the New World Order, we wrote that a real estate crisis will start the next world economic crisis. And when it began the spring before, they tried to tell us, yeah, there's a continuously upswing situation in the next 20 years. We had a prognosis of this crisis before because we knew that the capital, the surplus capital, always comes into contradiction with the things the people can afford. And so it must get into a crisis because capitalism cannot develop further. That's why it always has crisis. And it's important that the Marxist-Leninists stick with the basics and are always in accordance with truth. To disregard the dialectical method was one of the fundamental problems of the old communist movement, which made it possible for the petty bourgeois mode of thinking to penetrate the communist movement and that former revolutionary parties transform themselves into bourgeois parties. Modern revisionism uses the ideology of Marxism-Leninism only as a phrase. Like the KP China, they still call themselves a communist party, even though there are more millions than in any other party of the world. Thousands of millions, millionaires, billionaires in the communist party. The delegates can be bought by this so-called communist millionaires. They buy their delegates. What kind of people's congress is that? That's got nothing to do with socialism, it's bureaucratic capitalism. And paints the wrong picture of Marxism-Leninism. Today, they're challenging the US for world domination, a very dangerous thing. Lenin not only was a big theoretician and a role model in applying the dialectical method, he was also a role model leader of the revolutionary working class movement, and our party adopted a lot of him. Lenin said, I quote, Communism starts where on a big scale free work is done by the individual for the benefit of society, not regulated by the state. Period. Free, voluntary work without any personal advantage. This is what we do. If we organize a big event here, then it's only possible because of all these people working voluntarily. We don't have to pay them 20 euro like the SPD to stand an hour at the information stand. We have voluntaries, voluntary work. This house, the other houses, we built or rebuilt them with our own work. 300,000 hours of unpaid work is in this house. We don't need the company for to do that. People keep saying, where do you have the money from? We don't have money. We have workers who work free for socialism and we don't have to pay them or to promise them anything. Lenin deprecated it. A functionalist of the party fiddled for private benefit or advantage. And he introduced a party maximum for functionaries. In our MLPD, we introduced from the beginning such a party maximum at an average workers' wage maximum. If we should succeed to get a parliament seat, nobody gets the 10,000 euro. He gives away everything except of an average worker's wage. Otherwise, he cannot run. These are our principles. We don't want politics for your own private advantage. We want to serve the people. This is our policy. The party maximum pay should prevent. I don't think it's a bad thing to work with party maximum. It's even a bit lower than a normal worker, skilled worker. Right now it's about 1,040 euros. And you can't live with that. You don't have to go to clubs or bars all the time, drink or smoke. Then you get along with that. Of course, people who have women and kids get a bit more, but you don't have to have a highlight life. You can lead a modest life. Millions of people in our country do that. And they justifiably do not trust people who do only this legalized corruption in politics. This maximum is to prevent that the material incentive is the driving force for thinking, feeling and acting of our functionaries and members. Everyone should give his or her best selflessly and lead a modest life. With such a proletarian mode of thinking, it's possible that the proletarian class struggle develops further. The party met closely with the masses of the workers, and party and socialism can successfully be constructed. With the petty bourgeois mode of thinking on the other side, neither the party nor the socialism can be built. Then you just sway around, like in weather, you only do what you like to do. You refrain from your basics, we see it with the Green Party or the Left Party. They only say what the bourgeois parties say until they are a bourgeois party themselves. No way this is happening to us. We are firm, I've done it for 50 years and we never deviated from that. Lenin, as well as Marx, was a glowing internationalist. He was convinced. A successful victory of socialism is only possible on international level. Thus, for him, the October Revolution was only the beginning of an international socialist revolution. Under his leadership, 1919, the Communist International was found. At that time, there was a revolutionary situation all over the world. Lenin molded the vision of the unified socialist states of the world, which cooperate for mutual benefit, in which no wars, exploitation or oppression of the one country by the other, of the workers by the capitalists, existed anymore. That the continuation of the international revolution, despite of the almost 5-year ongoing revolutionary crisis in Germany, was suffocated in blood
was due to the fact that the objective preconditions of the internationalization of the production had not been advanced enough. Even Germany was basically an agrarian country. In 1930s, 75% of the population were peasants. 75%. Also, the industrial proletariat was quite small. More than in Russia, but still quite small. Most of the countries at that time. Today we have an industrialized world, international production, a high cultural level of the workers, completely different preconditions. The internationalization of production and trade are decisive basis for a new approach to socialism or socialist revolution can be successful. However, we do know that the internationalization of the production always shakes up the chains of the national state order. It's an insoluble problem which will either lead to a new world war or to an international socialist revolution. This is the decision that mankind faces, whether they are conscious about it or not. Either we go down in capitalist barbarity and world war, environmental catastrophe, destroying many people's lives, or we go to the evil of capitalism and create freedom for mankind and nature without exploitation and oppression. The unity of mankind and nature without exploitation and oppression. Already Marx and Engels developed the basics for a societal order in unity of man and nature. From the beginning, Lenin had a vision of an electrified society, which mainly relies on renewable energies. In 1918, guys, 1918, they didn't fire their power stations with oil or coal. They had renewable energy, and they were the only country at that time. Of course, he did not know a global environmental catastrophe. And on the basis of the socialist environmental policy, the Marxist-Leninist ecology, the MLPD still builds today. We do know that the global environmental catastrophe can only be prevented if the socialism will have been victorious over capitalism worldwide beforehand. This is why environmental policy has become an essential part of our revolutionary rank and file work. If we erect this statue today, we oblige ourselves at the same time to hold on to Marxism-Leninism and to consequently continue the doctrines, the teachings of Marx and Lenin, but always to use our own head, to not be dependent of some people or other parties that finance us. We've never done that. MLPD has never accepted a penny of anyone else than the people in the party. And the KP of China in 1975 wanted to donate as books for 100,000 D-Mark. We made a campaign, a donation campaign, and paid this 100,000 D-Mark in a few weeks. And we were not dependent on this. This has always been our principle, and it will remain to be one. In the countries, of course, where they don't have the material basics to do the work, of course we help. We will not allow anti-communism to throw dirt on Marxism-Leninism and their great theoretical heads and the practical leaders of the revolutionary working class movement, and to oust them out of history by systematic manipulation of the opinion. You see this nice public building over there? No, they use it to start this campaign. History of Communism by a certain Könen. He was born in Gelsenkirchen. He was one of the leaders of KBV, one of the biggest ML organization in the 1970s. But he himself didn't even dare to come to the opening. There were three people, only people who organized the thing. Not one person came, and I think it's correct this way. What's the use of that? People always on the first day showed that they don't want it, this
Exhibition. Over there, some people, shame on you, they say. No, listen, I don't think it's a bad thing that you are so close and listening. Maybe something gets into your head to understand something. You don't look like... that some people gave you millions. You look like workers, then behave in that way. International solidarity. And don't let yourself be caught in the reactionary way and fight against the communists. Long live international solidarity.
Internationale Solidarität. Hoch die internationale Solidarität.
This statue is a victory against the manipulation of the opinion and did create high excitement, especially in the bourgeois camp. I have to say, anti-communism is one of the darkest corners of bourgeois democracy. So undemocratic, so few tolerant, so unscientific as anti-communism is, no other area of bourgeois life is. Trump explains the corona crisis was invented by the communists. There are no communist countries at all. But it's always the communists that are blamed for anything that happens. But there are no communist or socialist countries anymore. Everything that went wrong in history, they try to blame it on the communists. You can twist history in this way, of course. Recently I read that 100 million people would have died in the 20th century for communism. Then I started counting and found out First World War, Second World War, the communists are to blame for that. The Second World War, as everyone knows, Hitler fascism invaded Soviet Union in order to destroy world communism. And then the anti-communist twists it in this way to say, if there hadn't been communists, Hitler wouldn't have been invaded. So Stalin was the one who caused the First World War. Is everyone silly? You could say, if some people invade, breaks into your flat, you could say, it's your fault. If you hadn't had a flat, nobody could have broken in. What nonsense is this in this bourgeois scientific? But this is the line of bourgeois anti-communism. So low we have sunk. Let's discuss on a higher level. Let's orient to the facts. Don't copy all the fascist stories that the Nazis in the 1920s and 30s developed. The first biographies of Lenin and Stalin were made by NSDAP. And later everyone copies these writings. All these horror stories without having a think about what is the actual truth. No chance for anti-communism. And this is why we have this nice statue. This excitement, which has emerged in the bourgeois camp today, is very healthy because it contains a new societal debate on Marx and Lenin, which is urgently necessary and has to replace the undemocratic anti-communism. Anti-communism is not only a world outlook, it's also a practice. 1997, the court declared that I don't have no bourgeois democratic rights and freedoms. Not because I have done anything wrong, yeah, I admit, I once had a little traffic thing, but nothing else that I would have done wrong. It's just they could withdraw my rights of freedom, of opinion, of expression, of speech, my freedom of coalition, because I am a leading Marxist-Leninist. 2 years ago in Thuringia, where we have a government of the left party, I was called a dangerous person. Dangerous person connected to the fact that there was a rebellious anti-fascist music festival, and I was one of the supporters. I didn't even organize it. I was just giving my name, just like Konstantin Wecker or many other well-known artists or politicians of Germany. So far, I was never not even allowed to lead a court trial in Thuringia against this. They calling me a dangerous person. So far goes the undemocratic attitude towards Marxist-Leninists. Many people were expelled from the trade unions, not because they're bad trade unionists, but because they are Marxist-Leninists. In Munich, 10 people of ATIF are in prison because they are communists. They couldn't prove anything that they have done wrong. They've been sitting in prison for years just because they are Marxist-Leninists. Why are they so afraid of Marxist-Leninists? Can't we do it with democratic measures? Do we have to apply fascist methods? I have to say, put an end to this. Society needs discussion and visions. And only with a clear world outlook and an applying theoretical basis we can do this. Long live Lenin, long live Marxism-Leninism, onward with MLPD and the international Marxist-Leninist and working class movement on the path to the unified socialist countries of the world. Thank you. Long live international solidarity.
Die internationale Solidarität. Vielen Dank.
Thank you, Stefan Engel, for this fundamental and militant contribution. I'd like to inform you how many people we have here now. We said we would be 300. If we count every squares, we are now 800 participants all around here to erect this Lenin statue. Welcome to all of you. Now, of course, we don't want to keep anyone waiting. Lenin shouldn't be too long in the sun. Now we start the unveiling of the Lenin statue by Gabi Fechner, Stefan Engel and Anna Föhringer of the Youth League Rebel.
Völker hört die Signale
Yeah, only one thing left for us. Welcome, Lenin, to Gelsenkirchen-Hof in front of the party center of the Marxist-Leninist Party of Germany. Welcome. It was a special moment. We've been waiting for a long time, also due to Corona, and you all have been part of it. Our friendly salespersons will go around and offer you a freshly printed remembering postcard again for donations. You should give generously. Karl Marx should also be bought. So every cent or euro that you pay for this is a good thing. I would like to say thank you to Richard Rezzetti. He's a worker and a pigeon breeder from Gelsenkirchen. The pigeon is called to be the horse of the normal man. He brought our pigeons. Welcome, he's standing over here and you can see them flying there. And he wants to tell us that pigeons stand for freedom, which is why they fit. Thank you for your pigeons and this part of the event. Well, thank you. There was a lot of talk in public, sometimes competent, sometimes incompetent, or just with prejudices. Our youth league rebel informed themselves who Lenin was, actually. I asked Jackie and Rainer to come to the stage. Welcome.
22. April 1870. Wladimir Iljitsch Uljanow.
22 April 1870. Wladimir Iljitsch Uljanow, Lenin, is born in Simbirsk. 1887, his brother Alexander is executed. The charge: participation in preparations for the murder of the Tsar. Lenin decided to follow the path of revolutionary struggle, but he says, we have to do it differently. Lenin studies the work of Karl Marx. He goes to St. Petersburg in order to link with the working class, which is mostly there. He founds the League of Struggle for the Emancipation of the Working Class. You're arrested and you will be banned to East Siberia for 3 years. Lenin and Nadezhda Krupskaya, also banished, marry. 1900, the banishment ends. Lenin has to go to exile. In his work, What is to be Done?, Lenin develops the principles of the Marxist-Leninist Party. The Second Party Congress in 1903, under Lenin's leadership, the majority in Russian Bolsheviki decide a revolutionary class party which has the ability to lead the struggle of the proletariat. 1905, revolution against the Tsar. From exile, Lenin untiringly provides guidance. Hundreds of thousands must organize themselves. The armed insurrection must be prepared. In November 1905, Lenin and his wife return to Russia. Workers and peasants' councils, the so-called Soviets, emerge. The revolution is drowned in blood. A time of brutal persecution and liquidation of thousands of revolutionary workers begins, but the workers demonstrate backbone. 1908, Lenin writes Materialism and Imperial Criticism. He works out the opposite point of view to capitalism and creates clarity with materialist dialectics. Before First World War, Lenin fights the emergent chauvinism. Almost all social democratic parties betray the working class. When the war breaks out, they side with the rulers of their countries. Only Lenin's party and his followers remain true to internationalism. In Germany, also Karl Liebknecht and Rosa Luxemburg are part of that. 1916, his work Imperialism, the Highest Stage of Capitalism appears. In the middle of the World War, he proves Imperialism is dying capitalism. 1917, the February Revolution topples the Tsar. The provisional government under Kerensky continues the murderous First World War. April 1917, Lenin returns to Russia. With his April thesis, he gives the message, the revolution that has begun must be continued and socialism achieved. Little by little, the Bolsheviks gain the confidence of the workers, peasants and soldiers. At the end of 1916, they have 2,000 members. In mid-1917, they become a mass party with 240,000 members. July 1917, Kornilov putsch. Lenin has to go underground. He leads the party clandestinely. 1917. In Finland, shortly before the October Revolution, Lenin writes The State and Revolution. The CC decides to carry out the armed insurrection and chooses Lenin to lead it. On 7 November 1917, the October Revolution overthrows capitalism and establishes Soviet power. A signal to the workers, peasants and all people striving for peace and freedom worldwide. The Second All-Russian Congress of Soviets adopted the decrees on peace and on land. Russia opts out of the First World War.
unbändiger Hass auf die junge Sowjetmacht.
Unbridled hatred for the young Soviet power unites the imperialists. The white power wants to destroy socialism. But the workers and peasants of Russia defend their country with all sacrifices. 1922, the hard-won peace comes, the Soviet Union is founded. Socialism is constructed. On the 21st January of 1924, Lenin dies at the age of just 53. Today, we erect a memorial in honor of an unforgettable model. The border station is crossed, the bridges are naked, locomotive 293 is on fire, and Jalava laughs into the wind in the October rain. Heater, if we're over there, times will change. Now the October wind cuts into the last apples at the naked trees, at the Finnish train tracks. Jalava, Jalava, you Finn, what are you laughing at? I'm laughing because my senses are clear and because this train station leads us behind the border and Vladimir Ilyich Ulyanov is my heater. He's familiar with flames and steam. Thank you to this historical contribution of Youth League Rebel, and then the song Kalava again from Gehörwäsche and Pueblo. Us erecting Lenin here has initiated lively discussions. We received numerous greetings from Germany and all over the world. Please understand, if we would read out everything, we would be sitting here until tomorrow, the day after tomorrow. Every contribution will be documented, there will be a documentation. If you go around the corner, there's a video box where you can speak your greetings so that we can keep them. But today we have a little mix of words of greetings, especially from the friends and colleagues that are here. Gelsenkirchen is a city of workers, of miners. So one thing is clear, the miners come first. So it was not difficult to find out who will be the first speaking. First, Christian Link and Günther Bjelka speak to us from the Miners Initiative Kumpel für Arf. Welcome. Dear Lenin, we miners welcome you with a warm Glück auf. We are very happy today that you are honored here in our miners' city of Gelsenkirchen. At the Assembly of Russian Textile Workers, you said that the German miners did play an important role for the construction of socialism in the Soviet Union. Let us remind ourselves, the revolution and its achievement had to be defended by a civil war which was imposed onto them by 14 imperialist states. They wanted to to give the young workers' state no air. If the German miners wouldn't have prevented the fascism in 1920 with the Red Ruhr Army, a fascist Germany in the midst of the Civil War would have constituted a big danger for the construction of socialism. A word to everyone who can hardly bear this monument. I could quote our mayor of Baranowski in the newspapers today. If he thinks it's hard to bear, then he's objectively taken the side of the imperialists, which with all their cruelties that they did to socialism. We miners are militant people too. We miners are proud that Lenin, who was a leader of the workers, now arrived here in Gelsenkirchen-Horst and will be a model for the workers, and everyone can visit him whenever he or she wants at the Horster Mitte. So Glück auf, good luck to everyone present here today. Thank you, Kumpel Frau. Please consider if you hold your speeches, that friendly colleague will give you a signal if your time is over so that everyone can speak. Next, I welcome the representative of the city parliament of Auf Gelsenkirchen, Jan Specht. Dear people present here, warm welcome to Mr. Ulyanov, which has had such an unfriendly reception by the state city administration. I spoke against the undemocratic abuse of the protection of historical monuments and the waste of tax money, because this statue was financed by donations. Auf Gelsenkirchen and Lenin might have a similar understanding of local government, in which the people debate and decide themselves. Opposite of the on the square, it is named after the working writer Josef Bischer, and he stepped in for workers becoming writers themselves. We are exactly between two libraries here, the city neighborhood library Horst and the library of the Willy Dickert Museum. So who wants to paint his own picture? You can get readings of Lenin in both libraries. In this spirit, look off. Thank you, Jan Specht. The Bochum open workforce with a 7-day strike in 2004 made the management fear. From that, the Works Councilist offensive emerged, and I asked Kalle and Olli to come to the stage. Dear colleagues, we are Oliver and Karl-Heinz from Offensive, the initiative for a militant trade union works council at Opel at Bochum. For us as workers, this symbol, this monument of Lenin, is a symbol for a socialist alternative. At some point in time, precisely this alternative will be the solution of global problems, not only for the workers. Anti-communists or fascists tried to destroy this symbol. They claim Lenin in the October Revolution could be blamed for all the death in the war. It was the imperialists, the exploiters, who killed all the peasants and workers. The Tsarist family, the regime of the old system, the same applies today. Not the capitalists are to blame, seemingly, but the workers are. It's the workers' fault if jobs are cut. Lenin comes to Gelsenkirchen, visible for everyone. We congratulate the both birthday childs, Lenin and MLPD. Lenin, welcome to Gelsenkirchen. Thank you to the colleagues of Opel in Bochum. Now Women's League Courage, Representative Sarah Chenan and Natcha Afshari.
Liebe Freundinnen, liebe Freunde von der MLPD,
dear friends,
liebe Anwesende,
of MLPD,
wir möchten euch herzlich so
and everyone present,
Ausstellung der Lilien,
we would like to congratulate you cordially to the hard fought for erection of Lenin in Gelsenkirchen and to the 30th anniversary of MLPD. In our non-party affiliated Women's League, we have women in the range of religion to revolution. Not every of us is in favor of socialism. Not everyone knows Lenin. Some might also have reservations towards Lenin. As a militant Women's League, we have good reason and we take our freedom to deal with the personality of Lenin, its position, and we are discussing it. Welcome, Lenin. Long live international solidarity. Thank you to the representatives of Women's League Courage. We now have a representative of the migrants organization because he has to leave soon. I welcome Mustafa of TKP, of the foreign organization of the workers of the Communist Workers' Party in Germany. Welcome. The greatest revolutionary of all time. Dear friends, dear comrades, we congratulate your party, MLPD, for such a significant event and convey our warmest revolutionary greetings. Like Karl Marx and Engels, Lenin on a theoretical basis was the biggest revolutionary of all time. For our times and the fundamental questions of proletarian revolution of our time, if we want to understand it, we owe it to him. On the other hand, Lenin was also the biggest revolutionary that the world brought about. And in this regard, he is unique. Under his leadership in history, the biggest hit against the exploitation and oppression was blown. He was a trailblazer for the first historical erection of a new societal system without exploitation and oppression. So this is enough to show why Lenin is the biggest revolutionary of all times. The already mentioned merits for Lenin and Marx can only be repeated. His name will live for the next centuries. Also, we honor him. Long live Marxism-Leninism. Thank you, Mustafa. Now I ask Professor Roland Günther to come to the stage. He's an arts professor. He teaches at university, and he's a pioneer of saving working class settlements from their destruction. Two sentences. Who in the region wants the conditions of Tsar system, the completely lack of rights of men and even more of women of 1918. Who wants to go back there? Those people over there and over there obviously want that. That many things change on human, social and society level. For that, I thank personally and publicly every person who steps in for that. To slander someone or to no. You can't tell people they are wrong, and I think especially Lenin. Go in detail, start thinking, and don't mistake him. Lenin is Lenin. Secondly, monuments are content. They are part of every European city culture. We need more of them. I wish for our region to have more life. And so far, we don't have any remembrance for that. I wish that this monument makes people think. How nice would it be, like for my friends Schiller and Goethe in front of the theater in Weimar, to have a quiet place
Karl Marx
for the fence couple Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels as a part of the city culture in the Ruhr region. Danke. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Roland Günther. Now a delegation of the steelworkers. It's Anne and Ute from Dortmund. The steelworkers in Duisburg, as we just heard, decided to continue their independent strike in the next shift, so the strike will go on. Welcome our steelworkers now with their greetings. Hello. We are Ute and Anne, steelworkers from Dortmund. We convey also greetings from many of our colleagues from Bochum, Dortmund and Duisburg. Special greetings we would like to send to our colleagues in Duisburg from here. You already heard that they are in an unlimited strike for a colleague keeping its job. We are in solidarity with its strike. We want to inform you that tonight at 6 o'clock there will be a protest assembly at the gate where the colleagues decide how to continue the fight. I've been a steelworker for 35 years, and for that time I've always been fighting against job dismissals, job cuts, against plant closures. This is why Lenin is our big role model. We have to fight for a system where humans are in the center of attention. Thank you. Now, Peter Zürk, he's a former miner from the pit of Lohberg, and he reads out an excerpt of a letter of Mrs. Litschke. She's 90 years old. She's not a communist, but she explicitly said that this contribution is in honor of her communist father. My name is Inge Litschke. I was born 1930 in Dienstlaken-Lohberg. My father, Paul Kresse, was a miner at Lohberg Colliery and a communist. Many miners, also the Lohberg, saw a Russian revolution as a role model and hope for the future. But there were also many miners who, under the pressure of threats of dismissals, turned their backs on communism. The families of the miners were not really followers of the Nazis. There is a spirit of solidarity amongst the miners. I do remember my father often took an excellent piece of bread to work. He secretly passed it on to his Russian colleague, one of the prisoners of war. I know from stories that miners left pieces of bread for the Russian prisoners of war on their way. It's said to have happened that guards, I think from the SS, brutally trampled on the hands of the starving people with their boots when they reached for the bread. It was a rough time. I wish that the spirit of solidarity amongst the workers at that time would again be more strongly in people's consciousness. Glück auf. Good luck. Thank you. We now hear Carlos Gomez from Berlin. He is author of the book Lenin is Alive and examined all the Lenin statues in Germany. In Western Germany, he didn't have one so far. Hello, my name is Carlos Gomez. As I said, during the last years, I've documented all the Lenin monuments in Germany. And on time for its birthday, it was published. After this event, I will be sitting over there at the stand of WENB. If you want to have a signed book, there you go. I would like to read out something from Dieter Kühnert. The chopped off heads of statues do not prove that they vanish. Deleted writings. Lenin cannot be overcome. This is the proof. Lenin is alive. Lenin is going to be alive. Going to continue to live. Thank you. Now I welcome Klaus Leiter, the head of our construction group of the Vermögensverwaltungsverein, and our housekeeper Thomas Fechner, who had the idea for the statue. And Klaus Leiter then transported it through half of Europe and erected it here. Welcome. Yeah, from our side, also greetings to Lenin, even though we have had the pleasure of having him here for a longer time. I personally brought him from Austria. Thomas had the idea to make a research whether such statues can be bought anywhere. With some problems and contradictions, now we finally made it, despite of Corona, despite of the bureaucracy, which tried to stop us from erecting it with some strange reasons. It's a signal not only for Gelsenkirchen, it is a working class region, the Ruhrgebiet. It's the exact right signal, and I'm happy that the masses that used to be standing over there have already been disposed by the city's disposal unit. So, Glück auf and all the best. Thank you so much. Now we start a small tour around the world. We start with the representatives of the migrant organization and of migrants. Next, I'd like to ask the representatives of APTIF, the Federation of Workers from Turkey in Germany, to come up front. Süleyman Gökçen is going to speak. Welcome. Dear comrades, dear friends, I welcome you on behalf of ATEF, Federation of the Workers from Turkey and Germany. Today, we are witnessing a piece of history. 30 years after chopping off Lenin statues after imperialist Russia, a new one is erected. It's a strong signal in a time where anti-communism is initiated by the imperialist states, a sign against the rightward development of the states, a sign for the people who are searching for an alternative form of society to capitalism, a sign against those who are defaming history. It's also a time for us, for our fight against the capitalist system, to continue this fight. Long live international solidarity. Thank you. Next speaker, Alassane Mouffour-Upon. He rightfully was quoted yesterday in a newspaper as the face of the refugee movement in Germany. In a four-hour trial yesterday, he achieved that two court trials because of alleged illegal entrance were stopped. So welcome, Alassane Mouffour-Upon. Thank you, Peter. My name is Alassa. I am one of the organizers of the refugees in Elwangen. I'm also representative of Circle of Friends Alassa and Friends. My refugee policy is my life, and now I work as a trainee in Verlag Neue Weg. This event shows the commitment to fight against racism in Gelsenkirchen. Welcome, Lenin. In Africa, Lenin is portrayed as a mass murderer, like here. But I learned something else about him, and I want to bring this to Africa. Thank you. Now the greetings of ADHF, Federation for Democratic Rights in Germany. I welcome GNU. Hello. On behalf of ADHF, we welcome all friends who came to Gelsenkirchen today to erect the monument of Vladimir Ilyich Lenin. We thank our friends from the MRPD who, despite attempts by the German state to ban the monument, have campaigned for this monument of Lenin to be erected. In days when the attacks against Marxism, Leninism and Maoism are increasing, the class struggle and the desire for socialism is weakening. And can you continue, please? She was going to say that is even more important that the statue of Lenin is erected as a source of morality. The statue of Lenin, which is being erected today in front of the MRPD headquarters, is the symbol of the struggle and victory of all peoples of the world. We hope this German working class will learn a lesson from its experience and extend its struggle until victory. Long live Marxism, Leninism, Maoism. Long live Comrade Lenin for the Federation for Democratic Rights in Germany. On behalf of him. Thank you, Gönnel. Now Dr. Khaled Hamad speaks. He's the chairperson of the Palestinian community and he also stands for the tough, decades-long liberation struggle of the Palestinian people. On behalf of the Palestinian community in Germany, I'd like to thank you, comrades of MLPD, for the erection of this monument of Comrade Lenin. The personality of Lenin, for us, means internationalism and solidarity. Join forces against imperialism, oppression, racism, for freedom and for the right of self-determination of the peoples, and to fight for that. We in Palestine also have to fight against US imperialism, Zionist occupation and Arabian reaction. In this struggle, we do need your solidarity and the solidarity of all socialist and progressive forces so that also our people can enjoy freedom in self-determination. We are sure that our joint struggle for a better world will be successful. Again, thank you for the international event which brought all of us together. Long live international solidarity. Thank you. We now hear some excerpts from writings of friends who cannot be here today, read out by Ulja Servay and Johanna Jensen. Hermann Kopp, head of the Marx Engels Foundation in Wuppertal, writes, "Dear Gabi Fechner, your clever idea to erect a Lenin statue on your own private grounds, but publicly visible, I admired. And I was so happy with all the reservations I have towards MLPD that you got away with it at court." Gisela Kluge, member of the local body of Die Linke in the city of Sonnenberg, writes, "When I heard about the erection of the Lenin statue, I was speechless. I couldn't believe it in the beginning. So much better that it actually becomes true. Especially as the citizen of the city where Marx just once had his home and where he still molded the cityscape impressively, I was very happy that now also in the West the big revolutionary Lenin is remembered. This is very necessary and very brave." Halinka Augustin, Suse Bader and Zaman Masoudi, European coordinators and deputies of the World Women's Conference of the rank-and-file women, write, "Lenin, the genius dialectician and his theoretician. His development of Marxism to a higher level is a trailblazer until today for the international revolutionary and working-class movement. But he is also a trailblazer, a pioneer for the women's movement. In many of his writings, he deals with the question of the liberation of the woman." Raimund Brethe, Communist Platform Saxonia of the Left, writes, "I want to call upon the young people. Undertake the effort and read what Lenin wrote in State and Revolution, as well as in Imperialism as High Stage of Capitalism. Not least, these works are being slandered by notorious anti-communists, because they can become a weapon in the struggle for a better world." Markus Becker, dairy farmer from the region of Niederrhein, writes, "With his idea of social justice and independence of the individual regions, he gave hope and courage to a lot of people. Even today, this demand is met with more and more interest." Herr Trautvetter, peace advocate and member of the unification of those persecuted by the Nazi regime, writes, "Dear fellow workers, especially in times of, in these times, it's important to remember the legacy of Lenin, who not only was a dialectician and practicing the thinking in opposites, but also makes it visible how important it is always that the progressive forces also deal self-critically with themselves. Regina Silbermann, spokesperson for the German-Russian Friendship in Saxonia, writes, Lenin led the working class to the revolution. He demanded and founded the party of a new type. Also, we in Germany need a party who shows the way to a new societal order together and can fight together with the working class with it. Dear MLPD, you continue on your path. Ilyich Lenin, one of his first actions was to sign the decree on peace. This should be role model and guideline for us today. The Red Unity from Düsseldorf writes, the erection of such a statue especially emphasizes how important Lenin's achievements and his insights are for the international proletariat until today. The statue is also a sign of reheated class struggles and capitalist crisis. It's a clear sign, without applied Marxism-Leninism, there can be no freedom. Thank you. We'll now listen to some lines of the song Partisans of the Amur. The song was written in 1922 in the Civil War to defend the October Revolution from fascist terrorists. It celebrates the victory of the Red Army and the peoples of the young Soviet Union. Over the mountains, through valleys, the division marched forward, our bold division. Up to the coast, the white led bastion that were battled for. And so we chased them away, General and Ataman. Our battle only found its end at the Pacific Ocean. Thank you. Of course, many people wanted to hand over some presents, and representing everyone who wanted to do this, we asked Frank Vetter here to come to the stage to hand over one of the many presents for Lenin and to introduce it. Thank you, my name is Frank Oettler. I'm from the city of Halle in Sachsen-Anhalt, 400 kilometers from here. And we jointly greet Lenin here in Gelsenkirchen. In the eastern part of Germany, Lenin stood for the start of socialism, for hopeful years, which unfortunately in the 1950s were betrayed by the leadership of the state. I was born in Halle an der Saale. The first sentences of Lenin were, learn, learn, learn. This is what it's all about today. Thank you. Thank you. Learn.
Wir kommen jetzt zu unseren internationalen Gästen.
We now have our international guests. And first I would like to ask Daniel Gülcher to the stage. He's a co-chairperson of CONMED, representative of the Kurdish Liberation Struggle. And he's one of the big friends of the International Solidarity Brigades to Kobane. He was and still is a part of the Solidarity Project. Welcome, Tayyar Öcalan. I welcome you as CONMED, Confederation of the Communities of Kurdistan in Germany, Lenin's 150th anniversary, the leader of the Big October Revolution, the Great October Revolution, which shook the world 100 years ago. The October Revolution was a pillar of many revolutionary parties and organizations, also of the Workers' Party Kurdistan, PKK. We greet Lenin as the first leader of a revolutionary project. We greet him as a clear enemy of the imperialist war, who as defender of the social liberation, social justice, peace and socialism, took a clear stand. As CONMED, in the framework of the Kurdish democracy movement in the 21st century, we continue Lenin's fight against imperialism and fascism. We call upon you to give more support for the courageous resistance of the Kurdish society against the fascist regime in Turkey. Long live freedom. Thank you, Tayyar Kötcher. Next, Anne Gosens will speak. She's Vice General Secretary of the North Korean Friendship Society from Belgium. She said to her that she has been an internationalist for all her life.
We greet you.
There's a problem in interpretation. There's a problem with the simultaneous equipment, so we will do it in consecutive mode.
Hello,
I'm from Belgium, and I convey friendship greetings. Greetings of friendship from North Korea to the unveiling of the Lenin statue. Since its founding, North Korea has been fighting against imperialism and for building socialism and for constructing their peninsula. Thank you very much. On Korean, you say? Thank you. Thank you for the greetings. Of course, we are in solidarity against the attacks of the USA against North Korea. There are different opinions. We don't think it's socialist, but we are happy about the greetings. Now, I welcome Franz de Mech from Belgium. He represents Ethiopia, Eritrea for the Eritrean Tour for Friendship. They organize the people of the travel of people to people to Eritrea in 2021. Welcome.
L'Érythrée a mené depuis 30 ans une guerre populaire
contre le colonialisme, l'impérialisme et l'hégémonisme. Dans les années 80, le MLPD a soutenu la guerre populaire en Érythrée.
Eritrea has been fighting for 30 years with the People's War against imperialism and domination. In the 1980s, MLPD supported the liberation struggle.
Du MLPD. L'année dernière, Wolf et Gabi ont participé à notre dernier voyage en Érythrée.
Our friends in Eritrea did not forget the support of MLPD. In the last year, Wolf and Gabi participated in our last travel to the country.
Nous espérons d'organiser avec la MLPD un voyage dans ce pays splendide en mai 2021.
In May 2021, we hope we can conduct another travel to this wonderful country with MLPD together. Long live international solidarity. Thank you. We stay in Africa. Mohamed Hassan from Ethiopia will speak. He's a friend of Horn of Africa.
Liebe Genossen, vielen Dank für die Einladung. Ich könnte ein ganzes Jahr über Lenin sprechen, aber ich habe nur sehr kurz Zeit bekommen. Ich will nur etwas sagen zu den großen Protesten und Demonstrationen in den USA unter dem Motto Black Lives Matter.
Lenin was the first communist and revolutionary to write on this issue.
Lenin war der erste Revolutionär und Kommunist, der sich zu diesem Thema geäußert hat.
In his great work with the title Shame on America on the plight of Negroes, black people.
You can finish the sentence, but then you have to stop. I'm sorry.
Shame on America on the plight of Negroes. It is a wonderful study made by Lenin. And his conclusion is that it is for the 21st century.
Er hat ein wunderbares Werk geschrieben darüber, welche Schande es ist, wie die Schwarzen in den USA unterdrückt werden. Und das hat auch Bedeutung für das 21. Jahrhundert.
I advise any anti-racist.
You have to come to an end. Okay. Time is left. Thank you very much. Vielen, vielen Dank an den Genossen.
Thank you, Comrade. You can speak your complete greetings into the video box. Now you're welcome from France, Gabi Fries from UPML, France, freshly gotten out of the curfew.
Je vous envoie les salutations chaleureuses de mes camarades de la France. Also herzlichen Glückwunsch, wir sind sehr froh, dass
congratulations, we are very happy that we've been invited to this big day. I am to convey the greetings from my comrades. They are all sitting at their computers and laptops now and are here with their heart. Now, a couple of weeks after the curfew has stopped, in France, the fights are starting on many fields. It's against improvisation, against dismissals, against the conditions in the hospitals, against police repression and racism, and so on. In these struggles, Lenin has to become a role model again and a guidance, because Lenin showed us how you not only fight against imperialism, but you defeated. The most important tool for this victory is the building of the Revolutionary Party. This is in the center of our attention in France. You are so much more advanced. 38 years of MLPD today. I can only say, happy birthday. Long live international solidarity. And long live Marxism-Leninism. Thank you. To France. Now I welcome Paul, international responsible person for internationalism of the new Communist Party of Haiti. Welcome. Ladies and gentlemen, New Communist Party Haiti, Marxist-Leninists, assesses this inauguration of the Lenin monument as a birth of the resistance in this area with a lot of miners. Doing so, we consolidate a communist commemoration and we relive history. Initiated by MLPD and organized by it, and together with the resistance in all over Germany, it shines a light in the struggles. We don't use this monument to travel here, but it should be a point where all the struggles join together and it should give a perspective to the struggles. Thank you, Paul. Now, Jeroen Toussaint, chairperson of Rode Morgen, Netherlands, one of the main coordinators of ICOR, the Revolutionary World Organization in Europe. And he used to be a dog worker for 20 years. Welcome. Dear guys, dear comrades, we from the Netherlands, from Rode Morgen, also celebrate this day and greet you. There's a storm going on in the world over the statues. It's about which path do we follow? The exploitation of humankind and nature, the races, the colonial masters, or do we follow the model of Lenin, fighting for the liberation of humankind? So, our warmest congratulations to this unveiling of the statue. I heard Lenin was a glowing internationalist. He devoted all his life to join together the masses of those exploited and the workers for socialism, which is why we are also a glowing member of ICOR, the international organization, and we will continue the fight. Thank you, Netherlands. Now, Colombia. I welcome Ricardo Fulminares. He's a writer and works in Colombia with the Truth Commission. Welcome. Hello. I speak in Spanish. I just want to add that the spirit of Lenin continues its travel also to Latin America. In the social and revolutionary movements, he is still alive. Thank you. To Colombia. Now we come to Switzerland. Silke, she's chairperson of MLGS, Marxist-Leninist Group of Switzerland, and she used to be one of the co-organizers of the women's strike in 2019 in the trade unions. Dear comrades, dear friends, when we of the MLGS, Marxist-Leninist Group of Switzerland, for the first time heard about that you are going to erect a Lenin statue, we were enthusiastic and we thought, this is MLPD, innovative, the right tactics at the right time. And of course, we couldn't miss this, the moment of the unveiling. Every day, so many people from all over the world are standing in front of the house in Zurich, in which Lenin had lived for a time. Unfortunately, there's no Lenin statue, just a sign which we fought for at the wall. At the same time, in the protests in all over Switzerland against racism, it is demanded that the memorials of those slave drivers, like the one of Alfred Escher at the train station in Zurich, who earned their money with slaves at coffee plantations in Cuba, are pulled off. We think our task is to awake the memory of Lenin, to remember Lenin, who made the first socialist state of the world, and to root socialism and communism as solution and living perspective. Thank you. Now we come to Banu. She's one of those accused in the TKPML communist court trial. Welcome, Banu. On behalf of TKPML, those accused in this court trial, I welcome the comrades of MLPD and the other present comrades. The statue of Lenin, he was a teacher of Marxism and the leader of the revolution. And it is a sign for the revolution. And we socialists and communists, let's continue this fight. I'd like to call upon you to come on 29 June, Monday at 12 o'clock, to the court. There's a solidarity activity with those accused in the TKPML court trial. Our revolutionary work, struggle for socialism, is legit, and we will not be intimidated by the attacks of the German state. No chance to anti-communism. Together, we can show this in Munich. Long live proletarian solidarity. Long live Marxism, Leninism, Maoism. Thank you, Banu. Please accept our greetings of solidarity for everyone accused in this court trial. Now we hear a word of greeting of TKPML, the Turkish Communist Party Marxist-Leninist, read out by Irmela Specht. Dear revolutionary friends, despite all aggressions and ideological occupation of the backwater forces in the world and the imperialist capitalism, the working class and the oppressed in all over the world still persevere to stand for revolution and socialism, and they fight for it. Our party, the representative of the Marxist-Leninist-Maoist movement, is one of the pioneers, part of. Keeping fighting, so we support, welcome, and honor all steps that we see as a contribution for the ideological and practical struggle of the proletariat and the oppressed working masses. We think it's very important and meaningful that the statue of the great master of Marxism and great teacher of international proletariat, Lenin, who called into life the theory and ideas of Marxism by the realization of the revolution of October 1917, is erected in such an imperialist country. Long live Marx and Lenin. Then please tag him. At least he was announced to come. Yeah. There he is. Welcome. You should speak to Aruba. Welcome, Farouk.
Sevgili yoldaşlar, öncelikle MLP'deli yoldaşları hepimize böylesine onur veren bir olaya önderlik ettikleri için kutluyorum.
Liebe Genossinnen und Genossen,
die Comrades, first of all, I'd like to thank MLPD for this wonderful moment.
Özellikle Türkiye'de yaşamı pahasına direnen yoldaşlarım başta olmak üzere bütün yoldaşlarım adına hepinizi saygıyla selamlıyorum.
Im Namen unserer gesamten Genossen,
on behalf of all our comrades who are in resistance in Turkey, I convey all of their greetings.
Aynı zamanda bilincimizi diktik, ruhumuzu diktik.
Wir haben hier nicht nur eine Statue enthüllt.
We did not only unveil a statue, our mode of thinking, our world outlook, and our spirit was erected. The fight against imperialism and fascism, the construction of a socialist state, is what we learned from Lenin.
Bu davayı sonsuza kadar takip etmeye devam edeceğiz.
Als Schüler von Lenin,
as Lenin students, his ideas, his mode of thinking, will be continued by us. We will continue to work in his spirit. We will continue to resist. We will continue to win, to have joint victories.
Asla kurbanı olmayacağız.
There's no way that we become victims of fascism and imperialism. Under the ideology of Marxism-Leninism, we will continue to fight. Long live Lenin, long live Marxism-Leninism. Thank you, Farouk.
Ja, wir kommen jetzt zum offiziellen Ende.
We now proceed to the official end of this event.
The
day is much too moving and too beautiful to go home now. We have food, we have drink, there are books, there's the video books for your greetings. You can also have pictures with Lenin and buy the picture for a little donation. Thank you again for all those helping people. Without you, we couldn't have done it today. Thank you to the hundreds of hands who were in action today. We will be listening to a song at the end, but please make sure we are now all in a good mood. But take care if you go home. We know what kind of people were close here. So take care that you get home safe and sound so that we can continue our struggle. Thank you to all of you. We listen to another song and the official final for the celebration, and then we will continue to celebrate. Right, our final song, it's called Time Has Come.
Hallo?
Hallo?
Hallo? Okay.
Test, test.
Unsere Natur ist wunderschön und reich
und weit. Our nature is beautiful and rich. But there's a problem, crying out for solutions. They step on dead bodies for maximum profit. Stop nuclear power. We are setting a sign. Time has come. We've seen it. We are organizing resistance worldwide.
Organisieren.
Widerstand. Die Völker können sich selbst regieren, sie wollen frei.
People can govern themselves. They want freedom. But there's one problem, crying out for solution. For oil and power, corporations step on dead bodies. Stop NATO, we are setting a sign. Time has come. We've noticed that. Organize resistance worldwide.
Organisieren weltweit Widerstand. Es wird deutlich, das System ist das Problem.
It becomes obvious the problem is the system. But still there's the question where to go. One thing's clear, we can't get back. We want the cake shop, not just a slice of cake. Time has come, we've noticed it. Organized resistance worldwide.